This morning, as I've already mentioned, we're going to be looking at 1 Peter in chapter 1. We're going to be looking at verses 3 through 9, but I'd like to read verses 1 through 9, just to give us a little bit of the context. So 1 Peter chapter 1, beginning in verse 1, would you listen carefully to this? This is God's Word. Peter writes, "Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who reside as aliens scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, who are chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father by the sanctifying work of the Spirit, to obey Jesus Christ and be sprinkled with His blood, may grace and peace be yours in fullest measure. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to His great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you, who are protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials, so that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. And though you have not seen Him, you love Him. And though you do not see Him now, but believe in Him, you greatly rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, obtaining as the outcome of your faith the salvation of your souls." May the Lord bless His word to us this morning. May He help us not only to know that there is joy like this, but may He help us actually to experience this joy in our lives. Again, this is what the Lord is working actually to produce in us, this kind of joy. He wants us to be joyful in whatever circumstances we have to face. Now again, by way of review, we have been looking at Jesus' command to seek the kingdom, to put the kingdom first in our lives, to put Him first in our lives, to live as He calls us to live. Now, as we begin, let's remember what Augustine said so many years ago in one of his prayers. He says, "Lord, command what you will. You are king. You have the right to command me." But he also said, "Grant what you command." He knew that he couldn't do it apart from the grace that the Lord Jesus Christ actually gives. We need to understand, when the Lord Jesus calls us to do something, He doesn't expect us to do it on our own. He's already given to us the ability to do these things through His Holy Spirit. We can do what He commands through His power. And by the way, He has also given to us the desire to do these things by that same Spirit, which means that when the Lord Jesus speaks, He not only gives us the power and desire so that we actually will do it. One thing that Jonathan Edwards emphasized quite a bit is the primary evidence, the main evidence by which we might know that we belong to Jesus and by which everybody else might know that we belong to Jesus and by which the devil knows when he sees it that we belong to Jesus and he has lost us, is the fact that we actually do what it is the Lord calls us to do. We have to move beyond knowing what's right and desiring what's right. We actually need to do what is right. But of course, we also saw there's going to be a struggle in seeking to do what's right because of our flesh, because of what's left of the old man. But remember, Jesus has given us the power to obey. We can overcome it by resisting the flesh and by yielding to the Holy Spirit as the Spirit puts the desire in our hearts to actually do what the Lord calls us to do. Paul says in Galatians chapter 5, "But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desires of the flesh. If you walk by the Spirit, you'll carry out the desires of the Spirit, and what He desires is what our Lord calls us to do. But the Spirit does more than this. He also strengthens our desire to do what the Lord calls us to do by focusing our attention on certain incentives that the Lord has given us to do these things. Last week we considered two of those incentives, the Lord's grace and the Lord's beauty. The Lord's grace, His love, His mercy toward us. We were reminded that the Father loved us from all eternity and determined to save us. He knew the cost would be the life of the one who was most precious to Him. That's what the Lord's table reminds us of. But He was willing freely to give Him for us. And we saw that Jesus loved us enough to come into the world, to come into a world that hated Him, to be hated and rejected by His own people, to be handed over to the Romans and nailed to a cross, and to be considered a curse for us, to endure His Father's full wrath for our sins, and to die for us. That is the greatness of Jesus' love for us. And again, the table reminds us of that. And of course, once He was raised from the dead, once He ascended and was glorified in love, He sent His Holy Spirit to raise us from our spiritual death to life, to open our eyes, to change our hearts, that we might believe and trust in the Lord. So we will devote our lives to Him. We will put the kingdom of heaven first because He has loved us. But we'll also do so second because that is what we're going to want to do. Because we love Him more than any other, more than anything. Once the Spirit of God opened our eyes to see the Lord's beauty, His holiness, His righteousness, His truth, we began to follow Him. Remember that the beauty of the Lord extends beyond just what He does for us. He Himself is beautiful. And that beauty lies in these things, His moral uprightness. When the Spirit of God opened our eyes to see that, we began to follow Him. That is ultimately the reason why we trusted Jesus. That is the reason why we do what the Lord calls us to do, is because that's what we want to do. We don't want the world any longer because we know it's empty. We know that we're not going to find satisfaction in it. Now we find our satisfaction in Him, and we find our pleasure and joy only in Him. Now we want to please Him. So gratitude for the love He's shown us and the love that we now have for Him are two very powerful motives the Spirit of God puts before our eyes to put His kingdom first. But there is another very important incentive, and that is joy, happiness, pleasure. Now what I've just mentioned is what everybody wants. Everybody that exists wants this. Everybody is looking for it, but everybody is looking for it in different places. Those who do not know Jesus, who don't love Jesus, are looking for those things in the world. They're looking for their joy and their happiness in it because it is the only thing that gives them any kind of pleasure. You only go around once in life. Seek for all the gusto you can. Where does the commercial tell you to seek it? Whatever out there is fun, whatever you find to do. Well, for the Christian, those things, again, some of those things might be entertaining, but only for a while. The only thing that truly satisfies is the Lord Jesus. Those who love Him, those who have seen His beauty, know that they're only going to find it in Him. Now this morning, let's think about the joy that we can have in the Lord Jesus. Let's think about the joy we can have here on earth if we put His kingdom first. We have to put His kingdom first, or whatever joy we might otherwise have, we're not going to realize because we're going to be grieving and quenching the work of the Holy Spirit. Now, Peter tells us that joy is to be a large part of the Christian life. Notice what he writes in verse 6. In this you greatly rejoice. Now, we're going to come back to what this is. But notice he says, you greatly rejoice. And then in verse 8, he says, you greatly rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory. Now, the word joy in verse 8 means this. It means gladness, delight, a feeling of inner happiness. So joy is a form of happiness. It's delight. Feeling good, okay? Now, all of us know something of what Peter is talking about here in our relationship with the Lord. We've all experienced joy at some level. But how many of us actually know it the way that Peter is describing it here, to the degree that Peter is actually speaking of? Now, I want you to notice the words he uses to modify joy here, to show us how strong and how full this happiness can be in our lives. He calls it in verse 8, joy inexpressible and full of glory. He says it's a joy that words cannot describe, unspeakable joy. It's wonderful, glorious joy. And then the word he uses in verse 6 and repeats in verse 8 further emphasizes what he's talking about. He says, you greatly rejoice, which means to be very happy or to feel supreme joy. Now let me ask, when was the last time that you experienced that kind of happiness, even in the very best of times that you've experienced in this world? Peter reminds his readers that this is what they could experience. This is what they were, in fact, experiencing in what we might consider the very worst of times, in the middle of the trials which the Lord had sent to test and to purify their faith. He writes in verses 6 and 7, in this you greatly rejoice, even though now, for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials, so that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Now, what Peter is telling us is that perhaps the path that we take to try to avoid the difficulties that we have to face in life is the path that will actually bring us less joy if we'll simply go on the path the Lord brings into our lives, a path of difficulty and trial, then we will find this joy. And that is exactly what he is saying. Now, why is it important that we know how to find joy? Well, again, if we haven't experienced this kind of joy that Peter is speaking of here, we need to know how to experience it. It's not something, obviously, that happens automatically. Otherwise, every one of us here would have a big smile on our faces, and we'd be so happy that it wouldn't be anything left to say. We'll just sit here and smile at the Lord because we're so happy. But you know that isn't always the case. We need to understand how this works. We all want this, right? We all want this, but we don't all have it. We all want to be happy. We all want to be just as happy as we can possibly be because it feels good to be happy. I think you'll agree with me. Now, happiness is ultimately why we make the choices we make. It's behind every choice we make because we're seeking happiness. Even when we choose to sin, sadly, that is the reason why we choose it, is because we think that sin is going to make us happy. We're wrong, of course. It's not going to make us happy. Our flesh convinces us that sin is going to lead to our greater happiness, but sin, or our flesh, is lying to us. The Bible does say that sin does bring pleasure for a while, but it always comes with a cost. In the end, after the sin is consummated, we've fallen into it, and we've experienced whatever little pleasure there may be in it, and we only have pleasure in it because of the flesh that's still in us, because of the corruption. After we've fallen into it, we discover we are far less happy than we were before we fell into the sin. And we should remember that. Every time we are tempted, we have learned that lesson so many times. And yet, how many times are we again, deceived by sin, thinking it's going to make us happy, and in the end, we're not going to be. Think about that next time you're tempted. Sin does not lead to happiness. It leads to bitterness. We need to avoid it. Jesus tells us to avoid it. The reason is because it's dishonoring to him. The reason is because it's going to injure us, because it's going to grieve the Holy Spirit, and we're going to be robbed of some of the joy we might otherwise have. Now, this is also too often why we choose the other things that we choose that aren't necessarily sinful or wrong. Why we choose one vocation over another. Maybe because we think we'll enjoy doing that more than doing something else. Or maybe it's because we'll make more money if we do this. And certainly those are considerations. But more money to buy more things that we think will make us happier. Now again, there's nothing wrong with having things, as long as we don't love those things too much. If we love anything too much other than God, it becomes an idol in our lives, and that's something the Lord's going to put his finger on eventually and say, it's got to go. But let me ask you, with regard to these things, how long do things like this keep you happy, working in a vocation that you thought was going to make you happy, and then you realize it's hard work and it's not so pleasurable? Or particular things that you really wanted, and if I could just have that thing, it's going to make me happy. It's going to fulfill my life. I'm going to have so much joy. How long is it after you get those things that the pleasure begins to wear off and the thrill is gone? That is always what happens with things, because things are limited. Everything in this world, everything that is created, is limited. It can only bring so much happiness. Only so much, and then no more. And that's why we always want more. We always want more. We get some, we want more. Because we think if we gain more of these things, new and different kinds of things, that we can keep our happiness going. We can keep the thrill alive. But it doesn't last forever. I saw a great example of this actually growing up. And when I was in my early 20s, I had an acquaintance who was in his early 20s, and he was one of those favored few that had position given to him, had a great job given to him. And because of that, at the same age, you know, where somebody is about ready to go into college, he's already in vocation, and he's making so much money that he could have whatever he wanted to have, pretty much. Everything that anybody wanted to have. And I have to confess, at that time, that's what I wanted too, and I was envious of him. He had, as I said, a very well-paying job. He was able to build his own very nice house. I mean, a house by, I think, just about anyone's standards was very nice. He could drive whatever car he wanted to drive, fast, expensive cars. He could have pretty much whatever he wanted. And yet, he was probably one of the least happy people that I knew. He got tired of things so quickly. As a matter of fact, he was the kind of person you wanted to be around, because if he bought something that you wanted, he was going to turn around in a very short time and get rid of it at a discount, and then you could get a good deal on it, and actually did get a couple of good deals from him. But one week, he bought a car that was like a $60,000 car, which by today's standards doesn't seem like very much. We're talking about almost 40 years ago now. 40 years ago, a $65,000 car. He bought it 1 week, and a week later, he was tired of it and had it on the market for sale. A car that the rest of us could just, you know, drool at the idea of having. He wasted a huge amount of money. Once he had that house built, this custom house built, as soon as it was built, he wanted to sell it. He was trying to buy happiness through these things, but happiness was continually out of his reach, because things can only bring you so much happiness. It doesn't matter what it is. If it is a created thing, whether it's a person or an object, it does bring joy for a while. It can bring joy for a while, but it cannot bring lasting joy. It can't bring supreme happiness. The kind of happiness that Peter tells us that we can have as believers. We can only find this kind of joy in the Lord, in having a relationship with him through our Lord Jesus Christ. And the reason is because God alone is unlimited. God alone is infinite. The pleasure and joy that we have in him, the happiness, is something that will never grow old, never diminish, never wear out. It goes on forever, particularly when you get to heaven. Now, how does knowing God give us this kind of joy? Well, We're going to focus right now upon how it gives us joy on earth, and then this evening, how it gives us joy in heaven. Now, on earth, it does it in two ways. First of all, God gives us joy by His Holy Spirit, simply by having the Spirit of God. It's the fruit of the Spirit. Secondly, the Spirit, part of His work in our lives, is increasing this joy by giving us the hope that one day we are going to be with the one whom we find to be the most beautiful and the one whom we love the very most. Now, Paul tells us, first of all, that joy is something the Spirit of God gives us when He begins to live in our souls. He writes in Galatians 5, verses 22 and 23, what we read for our meditation. But the fruit of the Spirit, that is what He produces in the lives of believers, is love. You know, He causes us to sense God's love as well as to show it to others. But notice joy and peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. If we're trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ, if we have the Spirit of God, we have this joy, this fruit of the Holy Spirit, but we know that it can rise and it can fall depending on how much He is working in our lives. So one way that we can experience the joy that the Lord has for us, the joy that Peter is speaking of here in our text, is by having more of the Spirit's work in our lives, being filled with the Holy Spirit. Being filled with the Spirit is not a second experience. It's actually a third, fourth, fifth, sixth. It goes on for as many times as you can be filled with the Spirit, because it rises and falls. Being filled with the Spirit means that we are under His control, we are filled with His influence, it means that we are seeking Him, yielding to Him, submitting to Him, and we're not grieving Him by resisting Him. That's what it means to be filled with the Spirit. And when you're filled with the Spirit, you are filled with this kind of joy. But if we have the Spirit of God also gives us a joy in showing us, in convincing us, in helping us to know clearly that one day we will be with the one that we desire more than any other. And again, I would just remind you as believers, the greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart and mind and your soul and your strength, and not just to feel it, oh, I love you, but to show it by doing what it is He calls you to do. Okay, that is the greatest commandment. And again, as Augustine said, Lord, command what you will and give what you command. You can't do that in your own strength. You can only do it by the power of the Holy Spirit. But you have that power, and you have access to that power because God has given you His Holy Spirit if you're trusting in Jesus. And so what you need to do is to be filled with that holy influence so that you will see God as the one who is most beautiful to you, and you will desire Him more than any other. Now, if you have the Spirit of God and you have that joy of knowing God belongs to you and He is the one you desire more than anything else, Peter tells us in our passage that no matter what happens to us in this world, we can have this joy, and it will not, nothing in the world can actually take it away from us. Because the Lord has really ordered everything that He has in this world in order to bring us to Himself. Now, Peter tells us, first of all, in verse 6, he says, in this you greatly rejoice. Now, here's where we get back to what is he talking about by in this. Well, first he's talking about the mercy that He has shown to us in causing us to be born again. We saw this past Wednesday, if you were again there for the study at the Hodson's, as we were looking at who is the Holy Spirit, we were looking at the heavenly birth. This new birth, the work of the Holy Spirit, without which Jesus told Nicodemus, we cannot see the kingdom of God. This is something that comes down from above. This is something that God, in His sovereignty and His mercy, gives to us. Peter says we can rejoice that He has given to us this blessing through the work of His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and that through this work we have the hope that we will be with Him in heaven. He says in verse 3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. We have the hope that we're going to be with the Lord in heaven, not the kind of hope, again, remember, that says, I hope all this is true. I hope in the end I'm not going to be disappointed, that there really is a heaven and I really am going to stand before God. That's not what he's talking about. The hope he's talking about is the knowledge that we're actually going to be there because we know he exists, because we know he is true, we know he doesn't lie. We are going to be with the one that we love the most. So that's one thing we can rejoice in. Secondly, we can rejoice in the inheritance God will give to us when we are actually with him on that day. The inheritance he gives us through the work of Jesus. That he's going to reward us for our work and that we are going to inherit the kingdom with the Lord Jesus as his joint heirs. Peter writes in verse 4, to obtain an inheritance which is imperishable and undefiled and will not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. The Lord has something for you that's going to last forever. You know, he's not taking you a place that's going to run down like this earth is running down. And he's not going to get tired of you after several years and say, you know what, I'm tired of this plan. I'm just going to wipe it all out and start plan B. I'm going to do something new. This is something he says is imperishable, undefiled, will not fade away, and it's reserved in heaven for you. You can rejoice because Jesus has given you an inheritance in heaven. Now, thirdly, we can rejoice that God is going to make sure that we actually receive it, that we survive through this world, our faith survives intact, and that we're going to make it to the end by his love and by his infinite power. Notice Peter continues in verse 5, to you who are protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. God's protection, his love, is the reason why you're going to make it. Paul writes to the Romans in Romans chapter 8, verses 38 and 39, for I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing can separate us from him. And I'll go one step further. We're not going to separate ourselves from him either. You know, the idea that my Father is greater than all, no one can snatch him out of his hand. His hand is all-powerful and infinite. Ah, but I can jump out of his hand if I choose to deny the Lord Jesus Christ and so forth. Well, you know what? God's not going to allow that to happen either. He's going to maintain his love in your heart so that you'll never want to leave him. So he will make sure that you arrive in heaven. You are protected by the power of God if you are trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ. And we can rejoice that even the trials that he brings into our lives that are meant to purify and strengthen our faith are not only going to help us to do more for him here by, again, showing us the reality of the invisible world, but will also help us to know with greater certainty that he is there, and that he is beautiful, and that we will be there by his grace. Those trials help us to have a stronger faith and to know it's true, because when you're in difficult times, you cast yourself on the Lord. And when he reveals himself, you see him more clearly. You see him more clearly during difficult times than you do during good times. That's just the way it is. He writes in verses 6 and 7, in this you greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials, so that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Fire purifies gold. Fire causes a little bit of gold to actually burn off. But fire, when it's applied as a trial to faith, purifies the faith and causes it to grow stronger. It's even better than gold. And the stronger our faith is, the greater our joy will be in knowing that God and all heaven belongs to us because of what Jesus Christ has done. Peter concludes in verses 8 and 9, and though you have not seen him, you love him. And though you do not see him now, but believe in him, you greatly rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, obtaining is the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. And he's talking there not just about the salvation they had already experienced. That's one part of it. But salvation is broader than that. We are saved from our sins if we're trusting in Jesus now. We are going to be continually saved from our sins from now to the time when we actually go to be with the Lord, and we will forever be saved and be with the Lord in heaven. That's what he's talking about. The outcome of your faith is salvation. You will be with the Lord. Now, if we're trusting in Jesus this morning, all of these things are true. They are objectively true, whether we can see them and apprehend them the way that we might otherwise, if we were filled with the Spirit, it's true. We're going to be with the Lord in heaven. That's because of what Jesus has done. It's not because of what we have done. But our subjective experience of these things, the joy that it might otherwise have, comes only by faith, by believing these things to be true, by knowing that we're actually going to be with him. But that varies according to our spiritual condition. Now, if the Spirit, if his work is weak in our hearts, we're going to have a weak joy. Not only the joy that he brings into our hearts subjectively by the fact that he's there, but also the joy that comes from knowing that we're going to actually see him. It's going to be weaker because our faith is weaker. And not only that, but our desire to be with the Lord is going to be weaker, which means even the knowledge that we are going to be with him isn't going to bring us that much joy because we don't have a very strong love. But if the Spirit's work is strong, we will have the kind of joy that Peter's referring to here. And that's the only way we can have it. Joy that is full, joy that is unspeakable, inexpressible, because we know the desire of our hearts is going to be realized. We are going to see him, and we want to see him. Now, the Spirit's work can only be strong within us if we yield to the Spirit of God as he seeks to move us to put the kingdom first. That's the only way the Spirit's work is going to be strong. See, sanctification is a cooperative work. There's something we have to do. The Spirit is working, but we have to do the work as well. We have to yield to him. We have to make good choices. We have to be in the Word of God. We need to exercise faith. We need to trust the Lord. Make good choices. We have to do those things. We can only do it because the Spirit of God is working in us. But there is something we have to do. Now, that doesn't affect our salvation. As I said before, we're not working our way into heaven. We don't do this in order to be saved. We're saved. But what I'm talking about here is our experience of these things, our apprehension, our ability to experience this kind of joy. That's going to rise or fall depending upon how much of the Spirit of God we have within us. We need his work to be strong. And to do that, we need to do our part. We need to yield to the Spirit and make the choice to put the kingdom of heaven first. How was Jesus able to experience the kind of joy that he did in the middle of such a difficult work and in the face of so much opposition? I mean, he was popular early on in his ministry, never among the Pharisees, though, as a majority. Towards the end, they were all crying out for his death and said, "Crucify him." How could Jesus have joy, the kind of joy Peter is talking about here, and even greater, in the midst of that kind of difficulty? Well, we might think it's because Jesus is God. He's a divine person in a human nature. But that's not why he had that joy, because the person was a divine person, but he was fully man. The reason why Jesus had this joy is because he was filled with the Spirit. And being filled with the Spirit, he loved his Father. And loving his Father, he had nothing other than the desire to honor him. And then when he had finished his work, to be with him. Jesus had joy. The joy that he had on earth that came from the joy that was before his eyes, set before him. The joy that his Father had promised him. He could see it clearly. And that's what he wanted. The author to the Hebrews tells us that Jesus, in Hebrews 12, verse 2, for the joy set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. The reason why Jesus was able to do this is because he was filled with the Spirit of God. And he was fully yielded to him. And he loved his Father. And he wanted to honor him. And that's what he sought. That's where he found this joy. Now, Peter's telling us that we can have this same kind of joy. We can have his joy. The assurance that we belong to him and will be with him. And of course, the love that makes us want to be with him. But we can only have it if we do what Jesus did, which is putting the kingdom first. We have to yield to the Spirit of God. If we continue to seek our happiness in this world, we're going to do nothing but quench and grieve that true happiness that comes from the Spirit of God. So if we seek happiness in the world, we're going to lose this. But if we yield to the Spirit of God and seek our happiness in God, we will find this kind of joy and this kind of pleasure. Again, it comes from knowing that we will be there. Now, let me just say this in closing. If just knowing that we're going to be in heaven and we're going to be with God can bring us the kind of joy that Peter is talking about here, just imagine what being there is going to be like. It's going to be much greater. We have the hope right now, which brings us joy. But when we're actually there, it's going to be even greater than joy that is beyond being able to express and that is full of glory. We are going to be filled to the fullness of joy and happiness. And that is what makes heaven to be heaven. So may the Lord show us that that is the case. May he reveal that to us by his Holy Spirit. May he show us the way we can see it more clearly and desire it more fully so that we can have the fullness of joy that he actually tells us we can have in his word. May he show us that and may he help us to seek our happiness in that direction rather than in the way the world does, in those trinkets that quickly fade away. There is only lasting joy and pleasure in the Lord. Jesus believed that. And that's the reason why he went the direction that he did. And he says to us, follow me. Well, let's bow for a moment of prayer and let's ask the Lord to help us believe this and to live this in our lives, because this is the only thing that's going to make us truly happy.